Great pleasure both for this conference and certainly for me personally to introduce Tony Vidler, who I think is kind of one of the most gallant friends of the AA and always a welcome speaker. I'm sure everybody knows Tony's work. It says here, he was the author of The Architectural Uncanny, but it seems to have missed out the text of The Writing on the Wall and the major study of Ledoux. Students for many years made The Architectural Uncanny the book that they kept by the side of their bed, and we're really looking forward to them reading it. And now we're waiting in the autumn for the publication of Warped Space, which concerns visuality and the psychogeography of the modern metropolis. It's a very great pleasure to welcome Tony Vidler.
It's true that I, for many years, kept Hegel's Aesthetics in its English translation beside my bed. And when asked by a partner why did I keep it beside my bed, I showed the first two pages read. Thank you, Mark. I will now have to obviously go into the psychoanalysis of gallantry in relationship to. I apologize if this paper is going to be somewhat expository, but it does follow quite neatly, I think, on some of the questions opened up by Mark this morning in relationship to the stages and the spatial stages of infantile sexuality. This morning, I'm going to try to sketch the coordinates of a question that takes as its starting point the assumption, I think, shared by Mark in his opening remarks, that psychoanalysis cannot analyze space in itself, that in fact it's pointless to look for the formation of something called the psychoanalysis of space, at least in the conditions and the assumptions under which psychoanalysis has worked since Freud. I should also make it clear that when I use the term psychoanalysis this morning, I'm referring only to that kind of psychoanalysis derived from and more or less faithful to the Freudian paradigm. Certainly space has and always will play a part in the psychoanalytic work. As we shall see in a moment, psychoanalysts have been deeply aware of it, if not obsessed by space since the beginning. But it seems only as a phenomenon of human civilization, bodily apperception and behavior, and not as a fundamental part of an etiology which of course is always traced back to the human and the sexual. In this case, psychoanalysis as presently constituted can provide us with schemas through which to interpret our behavior in response to space, but never, one hopes, a guide to the making of space that will correctly analyzed be good or bad for us. That would be a realm more proper to behavioral psychology of Skinner, if not of Wilhelm Reich, and one to be touched on by Sylvia tomorrow. I am in this sense taking the title of this symposium quite literally, and as it was precisely conceived to refer to psychoanalysis and space, its various interactions with spatial facts, ideas, and perceptions, as opposed to any notion of the psychoanalysis of space, although towards the end of this talk I'll come back to that notion. One further point. It seems to me that this condition is in many ways tied to Freud's heroic attempts to construct a psychoanalysis that disengages from a psychology that looks no further than evident causes. One that, for example, blamed space in its different forms for what it identified in the late 19th century as agoraphobia or claustrophobia. And equally important, Freud struggled to disengage psychoanalysis from any traces of its earlier animistic phases, where, for example, William James could draw inferences about agoraphobia from watching alley cats slink around the edges of urban spaces, or again, to where Tito Vignoli can analyze phobia indistinctly in animals or men. For Freud, it was important to distinguish sharply between evident phenomena and ultimate cause, and equally so between the animal and the human, and I will return to this question later. So let me begin with three propositions that will structure the talk, and I hope open up a debate not only in the past history of psychoanalysis deals with space, but on its future role as both space and ourselves begin to change our natures under the impact of the digital. One, that psychoanalysis has always been deeply preoccupied by and interested in space, but without, so to speak, knowing why, and usually only to discount space as cause in the last analysis in favor of a sexual ideology. Two, that psychoanalysis has always been deeply preoccupied with and interested in the animate world. We will be citing horses and insects, among others. Marx cited bees, as evidence of, if one could use the term, primate behavior, but only to discount animals as cause in the last analysis in favor of primal sexual causes. And three, that psychoanalysis only now is in a position to develop something like a spatial model of understanding, but precisely as a result of the blurring or erasing of the actual, not simply the virtual boundaries, between the spatial and the bodily, the human and the animal, both as a result of the digitalization of representation, where for the first time we're confronted with a form of representation that not only constructs all its objects, visual and non-visual, according to the same codes, but can directly interfere with these objects' own constitution. Let me explore these three questions in order. One, the psychoanalysis has always been interested in space in order to deny its role in the last analysis. Freud was in some ways a connoisseur of space. There's hardly a case history where space is not considered as a setting of the scene, an environment holding certain clues to the hidden forces of the history, material for the symbolic and the imaginary. And there's even evidence, as we know, that towards the end of his life, space had begun to change its nature for him, from a given, knowable, and universally sane condition to a projected or interjected mental product. It was, I think, Victor Bergen who underlined Freud's deathbed note in this context, Freud's enigmatic statement to the effect that, as he wrote, space may be the projection of the extension of the psychical apparatus. No other derivation is probable. Instead of Kant's a priori determinants of our psychical apparatus, psyche is extended, knows nothing about it. And that would actually correspond a great deal to what Mark has been talking about in terms of Freud's distinction between the a priori space of the world and what space does in fantasy terms. I won't go into the implications of this statement. I've explored it in depth in the forthcoming book, What Space? But rather I want to concentrate on a few moments of Freud's earlier spatial preoccupation, as it's those which have weighed on subsequent psychoanalytical thought. In the first instance, as I've implied, Freud was concerned to distinguish himself from the French and German psychologists of space and behavior, which meant psychologists of hysteria and psychologists of phobia. And we all know the sort of fashionable disease of agoraphobia, as Camille Zitter characterized the spaces opened up by the Vienna Ringstrasse. Thus, in Freud's early accounts of agoraphobia, he rejected hereditary as a cause, that espoused by Charcot, taking issue as early as 1892 with Charcot, and directly contradicted his former master in his notes to his translation of the Tuesday Lectures, asserting that, quote, the more frequent cause of agoraphobia, as well as most other phobias, lies not in hereditary, but in abnormalities of sexual life. Equally, Freud rejected the idea that the space itself or any material object of obsession was a cause. Thus, in the case of a 38-year-old woman suffering from anxiety neurosis, noted in Studies on Hysteria of 1895, the agoraphobia consisted of attacks of dizziness, with anxiety and feelings of faintness in the street in her small native town. The first attack, this would be good for Rem, occurring on a shopping expedition. Freud, through a combination of questioning and laying on of hands, revealed that the source of the disorder was not the street itself, nor the existence of a recently deceased friend's house on the street, but rather the coincidence of her expected period with the ball for which she was shopping. The same year, in the unpublished Project for a Scientific Psychology, Freud recounted the case of a young woman who exhibited a fear of entering stores unaccompanied. Her agoraphobia was proved by Freud by the fact that her fears were calmed by the presence of a companion. Freud succeeds in tracing her anxiety to the repression of a scene of molestation by a grinning shopkeeper when 8 years old. Following up this sexual etiology of phobia, Freud wrote to Fleece in 1896, proposing that the causes of agoraphobia in women, their fear of going out onto the street, were directly linked to what he called their repressed inner desire to walk the streets, that is, to be street walkers. The mechanism of agoraphobia in women would thereby be connected to the repression of the intention to take the first man one meets in the street. I'm not quite sure how that follows, but that's certainly what Freud imagined. Envy of prostitution and identification. This observation followed a detailed exposition of the notion of anxiety, as represented in the formulation, anxiety about throwing oneself out of the window. This observation seems to be based on a case recounted by Freud 2 years earlier of a young married woman who seized with an obsessional impulse to throw herself out of the window or from the balcony. Freud hazarded that it was at the sight of a man that she had erotic ideas, and that she had therefore lost confidence in herself and regarded herself as a depraved person capable of anything, thus succeeded in translating obsession back into sexual terms. While he'd be uncertain of the relationship of this case to agoraphobia in general, by the time he writes to Fleece, Freud has convinced himself of its agoraphobic dimensions. He constructs this anxiety as anxiety plus dot 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 window dot dot dot, where the unconscious idea of going to the window to beckon a man to come up, as prostitutes do, leads to sexual release, which, repudiated by the preconscious, is turned into anxiety. I want to throw myself out of the window. I can't do it because I can't follow through my desire. The window in this scheme is left as the only conscious motive associated with anxiety by the idea of falling out of the window. Hence, Freud argues, anxiety about the window is interpreted in the sense of falling out, and the window opening to the public realm is avoided. We know that the evidence in this case is a short story by Guy de Maupassant called Le Cygne, published in 1886, in which the Baronne de Grangerie narrates the story of her misadventure as a widow to her friend the Marquise de Renaton. When seated at her window in her second floor apartment overlooking the Rue Saint-Lazare and enjoying the spectacle, so gay this station quarter, so active, so lively, she had noticed another woman across the street, also seated at her window and dressed strikingly in red, even as the Baronne was dressed in mauve. Both, Freud notes, understood to be the colors of prostitution. The Baronne de Rangerie, recognizing her neighbor as a prostitute, was at first shocked, then amused to observe her. She noticed her system of eye contact with passing men, and sometimes on closing her window, how a man would turn into a doorway. Studying the sign language with a glass, she worked out a system of winks, smiles, and slight nods of the head that made her choice of men entirely clear. The Baronne, curious, tried out herself in front of the mirror, then emboldened through her own window with a mad desire to see whether passing men would understand her gestures. Selecting what she felt as a fair, handsome passerby and mating her sign, she would cover with confusion when the man immediately responded by ascending to her apartment, and further, in order to make him leave before her husband returned, she submitted to him as if she were, as he thought, a willing partner cheating on her husband for 2 crowns. Considering the affluence of the apartment, the man had observed, "You must really be in bad straits at the moment, the faire la fenêtre." In invoking Maupassant's phrase, faire la fenêtre, with regard to the formula anxiety plus window, Freud is in fact reworking the story to explain not so much the desire of imitation and the overwhelming desire to accomplish a forbidden act, the motives articulated by the Maupassant's Baronne, but rather to set up the preconditions of anxiety. Exhorting Fleece to think of Guy de Maupassant's Faire de la Fenêtre, and after a significant digression on the periodicity of his own impotence, Freud concludes by confirming a conjecture concerning the mechanism of agoraphobia in women. It is, he slightly hints, revealed by the very notion of public women and its structure, that of envy of prostitution and identification. 1 year later, in a draft M of The Architecture of Hysteria, enclosed with a letter to Fleece in 1897, Freud restated his claim that agoraphobia seems to depend on a romance of prostitution, a woman who will not go out by herself asserts her mother's unfaithfulness. The architecture of this fantasy and symptom building, as Freud termed the process of the building of anxiety, was then clear and illustrated by a celebrated diagram of the analytic work on scenes and their symptoms. For Freud, symptoms appeared when the fantasy, before being set up in front of the scene, became so intense as to emerge into consciousness, whence it itself was a subject to a repression that generates the symptom. A fragment, he says, of the visual scene combines with a fragment of the auditory one into the fantasy, while the fragment set free links up with something else, thereby an original condition has become untraceable, the original condition, presumably, of space. He concluded, all anxiety symptoms and phobias are derived in this way from fantasies. Beyond this, the action of repression between the preconscious and the unconscious, Freud proposed another level of repression within the unconscious itself. There's the soundest hope, he opined to Fleiss, that it would be possible to determine the number and kind of fantasies, just as it is possible with scenes. Such fantasies, he claimed, were root family romances, the romance of alienation or paranoia, and the romance of agoraphobia of prostitution, which itself goes back once more to family romance. Hence, by a labyrinthine enough route, Freud arrived at his conclusion that a woman will not go out by herself asserts her mother's unfaithfulness. Now, while most analysts have basically agreed with Freud on the secondary or displaced role of the environment in agoraphobia, where, as he summarized in the new introductory lectures of 1932, an internal danger is transformed into an external one, it's clear that Freud's own method prevented him from eliminating space entirely from the considerations attending analysis. Space, as it were, had to be examined in the greatest detail in order for it to be ruled out at the end. For if analysis reveals the hidden sources of anxiety neurosis, if nevertheless the apartment, the window, the street, the space itself that is identified as the instigator of the initial attacks, the scene, and whether or not these spaces are symbolic of something else, or the anxiety is thence transformed into an anxiety around anxiety itself, this space remains attached to the first fear. After all, the windows at which fictional and real women stood, uncertain whether to gesture for a man to ascend or throw themselves out, were the physical frames, as Lacan would later have it, for an anxiety that was, if not caused by, certainly figured through, private and public space and its uncertain boundaries. Thus, space was present enough in the beginning for it to be a prime suspect, and as we know from Sherlock Holmes, Freud's model in this regard, to exonerate the obvious suspect demanded subtle detective work. Thus, in the case of Little Hans, earlier Little Herbert, Freud is relentless in the tracking down and mapping of every spatial clue. As we know, this case was not itself one administered by Freud, but rather by two friends and followers, the mother and father of the Hans in question, the father a physician analyst, and the mother herself analyzed by Freud. We know the onset of Hans' disorder was marked by a communication of the father to Freud in 1908. Hans, he wrote, is afraid a horse will bite him in the street. That's a Viennese horse on the left. And this fear seems somehow to be connected with his having been frightened by a large penis. This in turn was accompanied by a distinct street anxiety, or fear of going out of the house, that manifests itself in multiple instances, all connected in some way or another with animals, horses of course, but also giraffes and pelicans. Streets were apparently indissociable from what Little Hans endearingly called all these animals Wiedemacher, no less endearingly translated by Strachey as Widlers. Widlers of all shapes and sizes haunt Hans's Vienna streets, and it's to prove castration anxiety over traditional suppositions of agoraphobia that Freud undertakes to construct its geography as a way, he explains, of, quote, keeping the two, anxiety and phobia, separate. We remember the day-by-day accounts from Hans's father of aborted expeditions to the steppe park, to the Schönbrunn Zoo, to his grandmother in the outskirts in Lenz, all in some way interrupted and haunted by carriages falling down, giraffes with Wiedemacher, horses in black marks, white horses that seemed ready to bite, and maids who played horseback riding on their knees with no sense of the dire consequences involved. The father obligingly supplies drawings of his own drawings of Wiedemacher. That's the giraffe with a whittler. In the first printings of this essay in German, the name Vidimaka was left off, and there was this horizontal line left, which was extremely intriguing to a number of early psychoanalysts, thinking that it represented the cut. And that's the father's drawing of the horse in the black mask, which resembled, guess what, the father's moustache. But more is required. Freud home steps in. Maps are needed of this complex and Vidimaka-filled environment. The father provides a detailed description. Freud draws a map. I quote from the father's description. The position of our street door is as follows. Opposite is the office for the taxation of foodstuffs. That's the warehouse at the back of the office for the taxation of foodstuffs is there, with a loading dock at which carts are driving up all day long to fetch away boxes, packing cases, etc. I have only found one image of what it looked like opposite the customs house in Little Hans's street, and it's surprising for that image that Hans was worried by horses and not by dogs. This courtyard is cut off from the street by railings, and the entrance gates to the courtyard are opposite our house. I've noticed for some days that Hans is especially frightened when carts drive in or out of the yard, a process which involves their taking the corner. I asked at the time why he was so much afraid, and he replied, I'm afraid the horses will fall down when the cart turns. That's a cart falling down in Vienna. It's interesting because that was drawn in the 1890s as an allegory of failed planning schemes on the Ringstraße. He was equally frightened when carts standing at the loading dock start moving in order to drive off. Further, he's more frightened of large dray horses than of small horses, and of rough farm horses than of smart horses. He's also frightened when a vehicle drives past quickly than when the horses trot up slowly. That's the first map which we saw. Then a little later, Hans expresses a spatial desire to climb onto the cart that is loading at the dock, to climb over the cart and jump onto the loading dock in order himself to load and unload the boxes, but can't do it because he's afraid that the carts will move off without him, thus preventing him from reaching his goal. His goal is desire. Another map is necessary. This is Freud's map of Hans's desire, his projected route through the gate, hop over the cart and onto the loading dock. A third spatial stage of Hans' phobia emerged in a more complex travelogue, to Schönbrunn in the morning, then to Lenz in the afternoon, from his house to the Hauptsollen station on the Stadtbahn, to the Heizig station to Schönbrunn, then the Heizig steam tramway station, all managed in a hurry. At the Schönbrunn, he expressed fear of the giraffe, the elephant, of all large animals, but not of small ones, not of birds, except for a pelican. His father explained to Freud that he was still frightened of the size of Widlers. Freud doesn't provide a map for the stage, but psychoanalysis, as we shall see, will eventually fill in this gap. All this to say that in commenting on this case, one that is largely epistolary through the father, Freud only having talked to Hans once, is concerned to demonstrate that not only are streets, warehouses, carts, and horses beside the point, they represent only the material disguises, as he says, of his fear that stemmed from a deeper rooted hostility to the father and jealous, sadistic feelings toward the mother, but that even agoraphobia might be ruled out immediately. We might classify Hans' case as an agoraphobia, Freud wrote, if it were not for the fact that it is a characteristic of that complaint that the locomotion of which the patient is otherwise incapable can always be easily performed when he is accompanied by some specially selected person, in the last resort by the physician. This is strange enough reasoning, and based on the anecdotal accounts of Westphal and Berlin and Le Grand de Sceaux of the 1870s, accounts from which Freud so much wants to distance himself. You'll be relieved to know that some 10 years later in 1922, a young man turns up at Freud's place, introducing himself as Little Hans, a strapping youth, Freud says, none the worse for having been, quote, unrobbed of his innocence by a father, an analyst concerned to tell him all. Indeed, he'd forgotten all about it and only dimly remembered the circumstances of the case when reminded by Freud. Freud pronounces the analysis a forgotten dream. whether or not he'd been cured by the analysis or by the subsequent divorce of his parents, thereby the separation of his father from his mother, Freud neglected to speculate. But if Freud's maps of this place emphasized the importance he gave to the phobic milieu, Lacan was to go even further, now intrigued enough by Freud's maps of little hand spaces to the extent that he constructs several more maps to add to those Freud provided. Under the heading Circuits, in the conference of 8th of May 1957, in the course of the year's seminar on the relation of the object, Lacan traces with forensic care the plan of Hans's Vienna. Lacan begins to study this topology with reference to the journal entry in the little Hans case of the 22nd of March, when the father brought Hans to his grandmother at Leinz. Représentons les lieux, he says, drawing dramatically a schematic topography of Vienna on the board, and you can see the Danube canal, the ring, the inside stadt, the inner stadt, and the Maison de Hans, which, as we shall see, is entirely misplaced on that map. The heart of the city of Vienna, Lacan writes, is situated beside an arm of the Danube. The house of little Hans's parents is situated in that part of the interior city encircled by the ring. That's Lacan's first mistake, and we'll return to it later. Behind the house is found the office of the customs, a little further on the celebrated station, often mentioned in the text. This is Lacan's complicated map of this, based on an earlier map. A little further on, the celebrated station often mentioned in the text. In front, you have a very lovely museum, the Museum for Kunst and Industrie. That's that's Riegel's museum, of course, where he serves his apprenticeship as curator of textiles. It's at this station that Hans thinks he will go when he will have made progress in crossing a certain field which lies in front of the house. Everything leads me to think, says Lacan, that the house is situated très au bout, very close, in the street behind the customs house, because once he makes allusion to the fact that very close to them is the track of the Nordbahn, for the Nordbahn is on the other side of the Danube Canal. There are a few Lacan's maps, again, of the railway links. There are quite a few small organizations of railways in Vienna, says Lacan, like an urban planner describing the city, arriving from the east, from the west, from the north, from the south, and further, a quantity of small local railroads, in particular a circle line on contrebas, that circle line on which the young homosexual girl Dora, of whom I spoke at the beginning of this year, probably threw herself. So we begin to track down the environments of Freud's patients. Two tracks interest us with regard to the adventure of little Hans. There is the Lincoln Railway, which has the function of joining the Nordbahn to the Südbahnstation behind the block of houses, among which the house of little Hans, from which you could see the small carriages. In the interval, this line touches another station. This is the railway underground in parts that goes towards Lanz. That's the map of Vienna that Lacan is working from. Here it is that Lacan will supplement Freud in detail by new maps, each one developed on the basis of the city map at the end of Baedeker's 1909 guide to Vienna. Lacan is very careful to choose the 1909 guide, the year of the writing of Little Hans. On the 22nd of March, Lacan writes, father and Hans will go to the Stadtbahn, one station to Schönbrunn, which is the Viennese Versailles. That's the rail line that they're traveling on, actually just north west of Little Hans's house. On the right is the beginnings of the Museum for Kunst and Industry, and just behind that is the customs house, and just behind that, and given is the row of houses which Hans is in. I'm doing something here which I they will go on to the Stadtbahn, one station to Schönbrunn, which is the Viennese Versailles, says Lacan, to explain it to his French audience. There is to be found the zoological garden where little Hans is going with his father, and which plays so important a role in this observation. Lacan cannot resist. It is a Versailles, but much less grandiose. The Habsburg dynasty was probably much closer to its people than that of the Bourbon, because one sees very well that even in a period when the city was much less extended, the horizon is always nearby. So the notion that Versailles is extensive and Schönbrunn is closed off gives a characteristic distinction for Lacan that the French see further than the Viennese. After the visit to the Schönbrunn Park, they will take a steam tramway, at the time tramway number 60, which will take them to Lentz. To give you a sense of scale, Lentz is about the same distance from Vienna as Vaucresson is from Paris. And we know Vaucresson, of course, from one of Corbusier's first studio. Then he goes on and on and on about the tramways. And says, finally, this will allow you to understand what little Hans says the day he has a fantasy of leaving Lentz to return to his house when he will say that the train left with him and his grandmother, and the father who missed it sees the second train arrive. This network forms a veritable circle, but doesn't connect, a ring that doesn't connect, a boucle. The line, two lines that don't connect, but simply allow both to reach Lentz. For Lacan, these circuits are parallel to the circuits of the horse in Hans's fantasies, so he draws these two. The circuit of the 5th of April, the circuit of the 21st of April, and the impossible, the park. Then Lacan enters the environment mapped by Freud earlier, that of Hans's house and the customs house across the street. He reproduces there the map that Freud reproduces. And he goes in great detail about in front of the house, the horse-drawn carts come to be loaded and unloaded. They line up along an unloading ramp. Thus, for the first time that little Hans begins to explain a little about his horse phobia, the tangent of the system circuit of the horse with the system circuit of the railroad is indicated in the clearest way. And then, what does little Hans do on the 5th of April? He has a fantasy of jumping quickly on and over the carts to reach the loading run. Lacan here goes further than Freud in noticing the significance mentioned by the father, but unmarked by Freud, of the front porch of this house. No doubt because in the Freud text it's called a porte cochere, and therefore French. The porte cochere is so important for status in late 19th century Vienna, concerning which the mother, on moving to the city, emphasized to the father, to change floors is not important, but the porte cochere, you owe it to your son, says the mother to the father. Porte cochere, the frontier that it marks, Lacan writes, is point by point doubled by what one sees at least close by, still in view, that is to say, the entry facade of the station where the city railway departs, that which takes him regularly to his grandmother. As an aside, I also would add a little architectural wisdom to Lacan's investigation, one unnoticed by Freud or Lacan, stemming from the father's note to Freud that Hans's mother was frightened that Hans might succumb to vertigo on the balcony of their apartment. For, as the father writes, I have once or twice told him to be careful not to get too near to the balustrade, for the railing was designed in the most unpractical way and had big gaps in it which I had to have filled in with wire netting. This impractical balcony was, the father avows, as if it's obvious enough, designed, quote, by a metal worker of the secessionist movement, which could lead to an interesting revisionist history of the secession as starting the whole question of psychoanalysis in space. But back to Lacan, that's a secessionist apartment house by, of course, Otto Wagner. Lacan has, despite all the care he has taken in researching Vienna, made, and he realizes, a terrible mistake. And it's not until well into the next session of his seminar that he realizes this and draws a new plan. In effect, last time, thanks to a carefully collected information, I made a little diagram for you where the house of little Hans's parents was situated in the street behind the customs, the Hintere Zollernstrasse. This is not quite true. I realize this, thanks to something that once more reveals to you how one is blind to what one has under one's eyes, and which is called the signifier, the letter of the unconscious. In the very diagram that we have in the observation given by Freud, didn't see it, he repeated it, but didn't see it, there is the name of the street, it is the Untere Viaduktstrasse. There it is, it is a hidden street, under, which allows one to suppose that there is on one side of the street a small building. It's indicated on plans of Vienna and corresponds to what Freud called the Lagerhaus. This is a special warehouse for customs and so on and so forth. This explains all the connections at the same time. The railroad, the carriage, the storehouse, and at the same time the house in full view of the entry to the station. So Lacan, in correcting his mistake and putting the house of Hans on the other side of the tracks and not on the left-hand side of the tracks, finds that in the correction of his mistake, the missing out of the actual street in which Hans lives is the solution to the problem. This is not, of course, Lacan's first mistake. That was to situate Hans's house within as opposed to outside the ring. And you can see that the ring is around here, and Hans's untere Freiheitsstraße, the house there, is in that first block. The untere Freiheitsstraße, and outside the ring. A question which certainly affected the uncertain Jewish status of Hans's parents and their porte-cochere anxiety. But we can overlook this. Lacan has come to a close. Voici, here is the décor set up. This is the scene on which the drama unfolds. The poetic spirit, and if you like, the tragic spirit of little Hans, allows us to follow its construction. Not without one more drawing, however. When Lacan finally maps, that's the aerial view of the scene, when Lacan finally maps Hans himself in the celebrated plumbing scene, where, as Hans recounts, "Daddy, I thought something. I was in the bath and then the plumber came and unscrewed it. Then he took a big borer and stuck it into my stomach." Freud, or the father, notes portentously, Hans's mother gives him his bath, and to take it away or unscrew it means taking it away to be repaired. Lacan cannot resist. He draws Hans lying in his bath with a big black hole bored through his stomach, where, no doubt, the plumber has unscrewed his Vivimacher. This leads me almost naturally to my second proposition, that despite all the evidence of animal phobia and the detailed study of anatomy involved, animals too are ultimately discounted from the analysis that is set on its course to uncovering a sexual etiology, a final castration complex that will release Hans from the bondage of his repression. I cannot enter into this exorcism of animism too deeply now, but I want to emphasize this. The psychoanalysis has always insisted on the deep and important distinction between the human and the animal, even while it looks to the animal as a source of understanding of the primal human. Here we can make two distinctions, one relating to the animal in man, a theme throughout Freud emerging fully in Civilization and Its Discontents, and Freud's own intellectual attempt to separate this out from animism in psychology. As we know, and as Adorno and Horkheimer emphasized in their Dialectic of Enlightenment, from Bacon and Locke to Freud, animism was seen to be the enemy. Its superstitions were to be routed out of institutions, social practices, and minds in order for a demythologized rationalism to triumph, setting a critical distance for the ordering of knowledge and abstraction of form. As Adorno noted, the disenchantment of the world is the extirpation of animism. A return to animism, then, would imply, from the standpoint of enlightenment, a return to magic, myth, and shamanism, and a decided refusal of reason, science, and the apparently certain truth of empirical knowledge. This is also implied, what is often enough stated, a turn away from the formulas of the rational, itself deeply implicated in the Enlightenment. But as we know, in Adorno and Horkheimer's terms, this very Enlightenment project, founded on what they call mythic terror, simply substitutes one fear for another. The fear of the unknown is replaced by the alienation of the human subject from the natural world, as they write. The noontide panic fear in which men suddenly became aware of nature as totality has found its like in the panic which nowadays is ready to break out at every moment. Men expect that the world, which is without any issue, will be set on fire by a totality which they themselves are and over which they have no control. This panic has been, and here lies the essential part of my third proposition, reinstated in a new form by the special kind of animism now possible through digitalization, which has in effect realized the Enlightenment dream of absolute mastery of nature. The conversion in Adorno's terms of the cosmos into one immense hunting ground, and as a result has brought the human into dangerous proximity to the inhuman. On the one hand, nature is entirely subordinated to man's reason, and on the other, it's thereby manifested in a totality modeled and controlled by the digital that merges the one into the other, setting up a boundary-free zone that no longer clearly distinguishes from the human from the inhuman, man from nature. But where once the limits of the human and the non-human were originally described in representation by the limits of mimicry, digital representation has for all intents and purposes erased the boundaries that were once the subject and site of elaborate rituals of imitation and propitiation, or in the modern period, no less elaborate rituals of obeisance to cultural precedent. In architectural terms, it's more than interesting that the kinds of software employed for the morphing animation and generation of form is for all intents and purposes identical to that software now used to develop bioorganisms, analyze and activate DNA and genome practice, and transplant, clone, and engender life forms. The interface between these two realms, consisting of artificial natures, sensing skins, autoresponsive environments, photo and biosynthesis surfaces, is likewise a product of and manipulated by the digital. And of course, there's little interface or firewall operating to separate any of these domains from the other. After all, a digital model of a genetic code is more than representation. A simple modification of this code can generate its own reformed organism. Such an elimination of boundaries between, say, architectural skin and our skin, architectural facades and our faces, between the morphogenesis of the natural and the human, and finally between the evolution of natural forms and the auto-reproduction of digital forms, naturally induces a certain anxiety in the traditionally described human subject. It's true that morph surfaces of the new kinds of architecture are infused, so to speak, by affect and to a lesser degree by effect, both properties that guard traces of the human emotion and psychic in their illusions. But these traces are themselves simulacra of other formerly material traces and entirely subordinated to the surfaces that they apparently mark. The insistent trajectory that digitalization describes toward the convergence of the architectural, the human, and the natural is also at another scale traced between the human and the inhuman, with the architectural object, once a mediating and protective device between these pairs, now removed in favor of a generalized model of nature that not only subsumes the human, but is technically controlled by it, yet entirely at its mercy. Adorno again. As the animate approaches the inanimate, and the more highly developed form of life comes closer to nature, it is alienated from it, since inanimate nature, which life in its most vigorous form aspires to become, is capable only of wholly external spatial relationships. Space is absolute alienation. When men try to become like nature, they harden themselves against it. Protectionist fear is a form of mimicry. In this characterization of the project of enlightenment, space, interestingly enough, emerges as the flux of anxiety in the site of alienation. In post-enlightenment terms, however, such space is entirely transformed by the digital. Indeed, there seems little that is essentially spatial in the digital world, save for its ability to mimic space as we know and experience it. As architecture moves from the space in which the human composes its relationships with nature to a nature in which the human is absorbed through the self-reproducing technologies of animation, we're positioned in a strange limbo of an apparently endless and developmental sequence of forms that, precisely because of their digital composition, are potentially the only real. Mimicry here becomes a key to the recognition of form and an instrument in the simulation of space. Even the space itself, at least as we humans have known it, is collapsed into the endless directionless place of string. In this context, it might be instructive to return to Lacan's original mirror stage meditations of the late 30s and 40s. For while in the first iterations of this essay in 1936 and 1938, the mirror stage seemed to have initially been derived from the studies of Bruller and others on apes, the chimpanzee stage, by 1949, the pervasive novel is not the evolutionary ape, but the insect, the praying mantis, the stick and leaf insects that were, so to speak, the major protagonists in the early version of the essay. In later examples, drawn from the studies of Roger Caillois into what he called legendary psychasthenia, these insects suffered from a self-devouring, self-destructive, hypermimetic impulse that forced them to disguise themselves as twigs and leaves, ostensibly to avoid the birds, but in reality placing them in direct danger from the twig and leafy eaters. What Lacan described as morphological mimicry was pressed in these species to the point of obsession, a spatial obsession which had a derealizing effect, no doubt the insect version of Freud's experience on the Acropolis. 2 years later, in 1951, in a paper read to the British Psychoanalytic Society, Lacan extended this insectology to include accounts of the behavior of the migratory locust, commonly known as a grasshopper, by the entomologist Chauvin. The reasons for this shift in analogy are not entirely clear, but it seems that for the post-war Lacan, the ape, or the praying mantis, would too simply and comfortably support the evolutionary psychology of the developmental ego. Insects, especially grasshoppers on the other hand, represent the more dangerous tendencies to schizophrenia and then to paranoia that were the inevitable marks of an imago constructed through reflection, distant, reversed, and scaled down, never to be internalized. Indeed, what interested Lacan in 1951 about the migratory locus was the natural switching mechanism that determined whether after birth the insect would become solitary or move with a swarm, as it was exposed or not to the vision of a female of its own kind. Chauvin himself had gone further, investigating the effects of light and dark on grasshoppers. He had discovered that crickets, when subjected to bright light in the crowd, fled in confusion, knocking into each other. This was particularly evident in the case of the field critic, who, he noted, was driven mad by the presence of members of its own species. Thus, he concluded, in a movie house, when a panic occurs, the spectators try without order to find shelter, and the scrambling counters the general movement to the exit. The study of crowd panic in insects must, for Lacan, have provided a convenient analogical mirror for the socio-psychological conditions of the 1941-45 period, and it's tempting to see the various iterations of the essay as a miniature fable on the psychoanalyst's own construction of politics after 36. As we know, the essay was first drafted as Lacan's contribution to the Marienbad Congress in 1936, introduced as part of a contribution of the French Encyclopedia of Henri Wallon in 1938, and subsequently revised at the Zurich Congress in 1949. Unpublished save for an abstract in the official proceedings, but published fully in the French Review of Psychoanalysis. Again, elaborated and extended in the British Psychoanalytical Society paper of 1951. The paper was thus delivered in its first form in Hitler's Reich, 3 years after the seizure of power. In its second iteration, it formed part of a collection edited by the very psychologist to whom Lacan was most indebted for the mirror thesis, Henri Wallon, on the cover of A Study of the Family. Its post-war revision was framed for the neutral territory of Switzerland, but refused by the English Ernest Jones for complete publication. Thence, no doubt, its careful explanatory form, as Lacan terms it when he gives it in England, the mirror stage pour les enfants anglais. In all these iterations, the mirror stage itself as model and described procedure changes little enough, but the successive explanatory context and adduced conclusions might be read as a veritable gloss on the maturation of psychoanalysis itself, as it's forced to confront the unthinkable triumph of what Lacan, in the second iteration of the essay, 1949, calls la vie concentrationnaire, which is to say that the stage is staged on a scene of spatial terror and does not emerge unscathed. What interests us here, however, is Lacan's own restaging of this terror in an imaginary masquerade he describes to the first session of his 1962 seminar on angoisse. Here, Lacan, somewhat bizarrely, imagines himself dressed up in an animal mask, confronting not his audience, but a giant praying mantis. Not unnaturally, given the propensity of the female of the species to consume the male, he's anxious that his mask be sufficient not to give away his own identity. But also, when he looks into the enigmatic mirror of the ocular globe of the insect, he is equally disturbed not to see his own image, but that of the mask. Perhaps equally disturbing would be the thought that through all these iterations of the insect as other, reflected in the uncertain mirror of self-representation and desire, it is the insects that are in the end mistaken for or projected as subjects, thence to become through mimicry the models for the subject's shelter. Crickets uncertain of their solitary or gregarious identity, leaf insects disguising themselves from one predator only to submit to another, grasshoppers in panic, all have recently reemerged in digital form with carefully studied and accurately acted out habits. And whether or not we may attribute the ant's wars or a bug's life to a fin de siècle Lacan effect, these movies seem to mirror the question of individuality and identity in the modern, implicitly posed by Lacan's 49 to 51 conclusions. In a bug's life, the ants behave according to rule, with reluctant princess and exiled hero subject to the will of the crowd, saved only by the invention of a group of actors masquerading as superheroes and the construction of a huge bird-like arc, both props to identities damaged by habit and rote. Maverick ants inside a paper bird launched to terrify grasshopper bullies, orchestrated by a traveling circus of masked insects, all perversely countering the agoraphobic swarm and its will to compliance. False and assumed imagos, then, as the only recourse in the world of paranoid schizophrenic subject identities otherwise bound for the boroughs. And as the credits confirm with their clips of the film shoot itself, this was a movie made by bugs, for bugs. Our only point of entry into this anteap would be, so to speak, as a post-metamorphosis being, one of those kinds of monstrous vermin figured by Kafka as already a kind of architectural construction, as hard as an armor plate with a vaulted brown belly sectioned by arch-shaped ribs to whose dome the cover could scarcely cling. This bug, whose scaly body could hardly negotiate its former perspectival environment, was in a sense entirely at home in itself. And as we negotiate our ways through the software tunnels of Flick's world, we might have pause to reflect on the relative comfort of the shell-like environments, blobs, and viscous surfaces that are being prepared for our new identities as digital subjects. What I am implying, of course, is that another kind of subject identity is constructed by spaces that are auto-generated by a software that knows nothing of a distinction between animal and human, and one that, for the present at least, is more concerned with the morphological and topological transformations of an outer skin or shell than in any humanoid dimensions of the interior. It's not presently clear whether our new identities will fully embrace our newly found digital kinship with nature, nor even whether our own biomorphic forms will endure as presently constituted as stable reference points for judgment and contemplation. What is clear is that digital mimicry has given the lie to any claim of the necessary human in the modeling of the inhuman, which is certainly, as Lacan pointed out some 50 years ago, a problem of ethics, if not of aesthetics. In the contemporary interpretation of space, then, it's as if space, with all its invasive and boundary-breaking properties, takes up anxiety for its own and carries it into the realms of aesthetic theory, representational practice, and modernist ideology indiscriminately, and without regard for the scientific ends of the psychological inquiries that initially made the connection. As Charles Melman, assessing the role of space in phobia from a Lacanian standpoint, noted, the phobic pays a tribute to space, not a symbolic tribute, such as one pays to a dead father, but a tribute to the imaginary itself, and we all pay one of these. We know, in effect, that there are in space places that are privileged, or those that are called sacred, and which are separated from the rest. The phobic is not concerned with taboo circles such as these. Everything happens as if the tribute paid to space were infinite, right up to the edge of the house from which hands cannot go out. Thank you.
Tony, it's a wonderful talk. The one word that wasn't mentioned, which maybe could come into this thing in discussion with the bug's life more than anything else, was the notion of narcissism, in the Freudian sense of the failure to see the other in the other and reading the other as a self. And I think, I mean, that put in the context of Christopher Lasch's discussion about the age of narcissism, might sort of, you know, give another sort of spin to the whole question.
I think what I'm arguing, of course, is that narcissism dissolves once there's no other.
Right.
If we are the same and there is no other to recognize.
Yeah.
Okay. I mean, if I tweak your DNA a little bit, right, you are no longer other to the digital that produces anything else.
But do you see that as a problem?
Well, do I see it as a problem?
Yeah.
I think it's a problem of that involves a certain reconception of theories, quote unquote, of humanoid identity, if you like. I mean, yes, I do.
I just wonder whether you can't reconfigure that within, I suppose.
I don't see it as an insurmountable problem.
Yeah. But I wonder if you can't reconfigure that within Kailua's discussion, which is basically about sort of strategies of defense.
Right.
Whether you don't see that as a mechanism.
Well, the Kaiwa discussion of strategies of defense, wasn't that in a way the an ironic discussion in the sense that the strategies of defense led to strategies of succumbing, right? I mean, that in the pressure to identify with something else that was other, right, and the merging of the self and the other with that identification, like camouflage, led in fact to the opening up of another form of lack of defense against those who would consume the other that you've now identified yourself with, i.e. insects that eat leaves. So my sense is that that disillusion is a kind of preliminary step to the possible conceptualization of a digital psychology. I mean, in a sense, I think that, and I was saying this in the break, that Lacan is far less concerned with the kind of human concerns, the whole human concerns that obviously Freud in his construct was ultimately concerned with. I mean, I think that the mirror stage is a demonstration in the sense of that the human is never what it was invented to be by a humanist. And so in that sense, you know, it's not by accident that Lacan's been used, and very cleverly, as a kind of pre-theorist of screening.
No, it's completely fascinating. I feel quite disturbed and, you know, disrupted in certain connections. But I just want to cling on something which I think I'll be coming on to tomorrow, which is the distinction between the digital and the virtual, in fact. And there is a point in the fifth seminar where Lacan talks about the unconscious as a virtual reality, but uses the phrase réalité virtuelle, which is a kind of, which again comes back to the anti-humanist point you're making part of the mirror phase. But that, I don't quite understand yet the point at which you map that onto the digital.
Well, because I think that what I'm seeing is the digital is really related to Marx's discussion of the real as opposed to the actual. I think that if one could say that when the digital becomes the only actual, then the problem of the virtual disappears, because there's no distance between the possibility, or no, there's no problem anymore, right? There's no distance of the possibility of thinking between, there's no possibility of thinking the difference between virtual and digital once the digital is the actual and the only actual. But I think it's actually quite a terrifying thought, actually. It's actually a thought that is potentially as terrifying as Pascal's sort of horror of the void, right? I mean, where he transforms it into a world which is of infinite space without maps, right? And the Enlightenment sort of invents the maps to that infinity through science. I think that what's happened is that science has now invented a way of mapping that is no longer simply representation. And I think that's the key, is that the digital is no longer representation only. It's really the first representative system that is not standing apart from, materially, virtually, and really, from its subject of representation. That is, it directly can interfere. As it represents, it can actually remodel, reshape, reconstrue. It can clone. It can do a lot of things, right? But it can actually become what, you know, all these fantasies of the Matrix, all these fantasies of cyberspace, you know. I mean, even to call cyberspace cyberspace, or virtual space is a kind of homely domesticization of something that's already gone, right? I mean, there's no space. And whether there's any possibility of ultimately seeing the difference between solid and void, even talking about inside and outside becomes a kind of oxymoron. So, you know, I'm pushing it to the limits, obviously, right? But I'm interested in what happens when you do that to the sort of, you know, the tenuous hangings on to the humanoid, the tenuous hangings on to subject identity, and so on and so forth, that we all assume lie under the predispositions of psychoanalysis. But the virtual and the difference between the virtual and the digital, I think, it's possible to theorize that now, but only briefly.
Just on this same issue, because when you say that you want to push this to the edge, I mean, one of the repercussions of pushing the thing to the edge is that then you end up with a dualism of the human and the inhuman.
No, I mean, no, you end up with nothing.
You are shifting. You're suggesting then that the Lacanian position is that which is obviously different from what you and Mark have presented in terms of Freud. And somehow what seemed to me interesting is that when, for example, Lacan is discussing this whole topic of I see myself seeing myself and this concept of reflexivity of the project, there's a moment when the investigations are not simply about being inhuman, but they're also about other ways of seeing.
Right.
And in the process of, for example, these virtual projects, there's also the possibility of interaction where they precisely have the moment of engagement as new forms of imagination,
yeah,
as a possibility, rather than being seen purely in terms of their not addressing, for example, ethical issues. Isn't there a way in which you could also introduce this idea of the other, basically because this form of technology opens up other ways of seeing, other ways of actually constructing new forms of spatiality? Because the way that you are constructing it, you see it as a kind of, as a finitude, as a kind of form of ending, something which really doesn't give you the possibility of an ethical engagement with the project. Whereas I would like to ask the question.
You want to preserve ethics, I know, I would too.
But I think that then this is why the relationship between spatiality and psychoanalysis in some way becomes very interesting. If there are conditions of imagining that rely on the possibility of the construction of the project, which is not the question of the real, but it is the question of the project that allows for that possibility of an ethical engagement. That is, the project itself is an ethical one. Otherwise, we have seen it merely in terms of the movement of technology and in terms of the resistance, in a sense, to ethics.
I'm not ruling out the possibility of an ethics,
right,
of this condition. But what I'm suggesting, in a way, is that it's a little bit like the Matrix, where you're in a world where you don't realize that the whole world is a concept that has been created in order to keep you in that world conceptually, right? If each of us was in one way produced by some form of DNA construction, that we totally artificially produced, and each of us was produced with specific attributes in relationship to development and biology, so that we would only know, right, those attributes and others, right? Now, presumably, we would invent an imagining, right? And we would invent a new psychoanalysis. As we are not yet there, perhaps, it might be interesting to construct a fictional hypothesis of what it would be like to be there. And I'm perfectly happy I'm asking for, in a way, another kind of ethics in relationship to transforming notions or transforming actualities of subject identity, right? But because I don't think that we are, because I think we are as socially constructed as we all used to be, right? I think we tend not to reflect too easily about the possibility that we are not analyzing the subjects that we actually are supposed to virtually.
Understand you correctly, I think you are implying that nature as other has collapsed, which I've written about here, but it seems to me that there is another kind of other, which is a kind of second nature that we've produced ourselves, which is the world economic system, in terms of finding a kind of imaginary at work in a resistance. There's another kind of resistance I have to consider, which is what would somehow or other, it seems to me that instead of imitating nature, as might have been understood in the 18th century, some of the virtual experiments in virtual architecture are in a sense imagining a climate in which actually they're drawing from a nature which they're not actually identifying, which is it's a man-made nature, and it's an economic nature. It's the chaotic, or proto-chaotic climate of globalization.
Right. No, possible. I think, you know, rather than that sort of, rather than push it to a kind of apocalyptic conclusion, why don't we step back and think about the notion that space as clue was transformed in sort of Lacanian terms into space as a kind of interactive symptom with an identifying and self-identifying subject. And the question mark is, what is space in a universe where the window, right, whether it's the mirror or not, right, I mean, if it's the Albertian window or the Lacanian mirror, no longer serves as a kind of reference point for the construction of identity, right? When that window is a screen with which only, in a sense, hypothetically responds to representation. So I think that would be the question. But at certain points, you can map space in relationship to the history of representation and map the psychology of space, or the psychology and space, or psychoanalysis and space as moments in that history. But that at a certain point, you know, I'm not sure yet that Freudian or Lacanian psychoanalysis as constituted on the basis of the window, which would be Freud, or the mirror, which would be Lacan, has yet grasped how to deal with the screen. I mean, I think that's really what I'm saying. Well, it's to read, I mean, both Freud and Lacan read them in visual terms, but then analyzed them as symptoms of something else, right? So I mean, yes, on the first iteration of our experience as haptic or visual or whatever, I mean, I don't know. I don't think it's just visual, obviously. You know, the body in relationship to a screen is not a body in relationship to a painting. It's not a body in relationship to a mirror.
I was quite interested with the idea of the imagination and space and how that interacts with the pathological, mm-hmm. or almost the inability, the effacement of either the other or the self. For example, little Hans and his phobia, or the Lacan's insect.
Yes.
There is an interaction between the two of them, if you bring it back to actual architectural space too,
right.
That there's an effacement, there's no longer an inclusion of creating something with an idea to be used or
right.
Used
and I think
experience.
You know, part of the sort of three stages of the talk are in a way, you know, a little bit parallel to the same kind of message that Mark was giving us when he translated the stages of child development into what they might be. Were they spatial, right? And what I'm suggesting is that in the endless mapping and configuration of the spaces of phobia or the spaces of mimicry and identity, where psychoanalysis fails is to translate, right, itself through that spatial experience and back again, so to speak, so that we're always left with a space which is non-significant in the end, right, in the last analysis. And what I would suggest, actually, that last stage that I'm talking about suggests we should look at, and I think precisely we can look at it now because it's possible to conceive of a body and a space that are one and the same as opposed to them something and another, right? Is that we actually can retrieve from those cases certain questions of translation in relationship to what would psychoanalysis be if it was spatialized at that moment, or what would space do if it was psychoanalyzed at that moment, in such a way as to actually produce some kind of productive thought about psychoanalysis now.
Maybe that point kind of begins to kind of answer some of the others. I mean, the point takes a kind of very old-fashioned kind of point. I mean, there's no problem about saying the subject is kind of faced with finitude, you know, both at the level of the subject's mortality, but also kind of original kind of finitude of the incense,
right,
in some sense.
Microsoft's death drive.
And clearly, in a sense, Freud feels no necessity to kind of conceptualize those in spatial terms. If, however, those kind of the unquestioned character of those begins to be qualified in the sense that what does happen to the incest taboo under, you know, conditions of the kind of production of kind of children in other ways, make up, and if
don't touch my test tube.
That's right. And in some sense, even kind of elements of death become somewhat qualified. Then it becomes actually kind of imperative, almost as an ethics, to begin to say what were the spatial conditions of the incest taboo that we can't just formulate as a rule that you have to track the prevalent,
right,
to work out whether you can or can't carry that. What's the spatial equivalent of, like, first and second cousins? And kind of same with death, because one will be looking there for what those finitudes coded,
right,
but were not absolute. It's the terrifying discovery that they're in some sense not absolute.
My sense is that potentially this will be a very uneven development, right? And it will never present actually,
right,
finitude or not. But that it will, in the uneven development, it will intersect very much with your world of economic capitalization and the struggles of that world between the private and the public, between the individual and the state, and will demand an ethics of that kind. It already does. I mean, the genome project is patented, for goodness sake. I mean, it's private property.
Slight problem with this, which is you cannot clone the psyche. There are no genes for actions. Right? All you can produce are two organisms, if going back to old-fashioned Freudian terms, with roughly the same instinctual constitution.
Right?
Now, coming on to Marx's point, I mean, I think then, contrary to will it matter, I mean, the incest taboo will become ever more a subject of fascination. Do you see what I mean? That actually, you know, it ain't, in that crude sense, biological. So people will actually come back to that. Right? The longer you live, the more you'll be obsessed with death. So in a curious way, both of those parameters don't get reinforced.
Yeah, what's very, very clear is that, you know, at the moment, and scientists have, you know, written papers on this, that
but the moment that the entire DNA system, the entire genome project is finished, is only the minor beginning of something which nobody knows anything about, which is development, right? So, I mean, we know a lot about, you know, sort of physical development and so on and so forth, but we know very little about how people are made, right? Which won't stop people experimenting. I mean, I think that the real question here is that won't stop experimentation, right? That we don't know, right? So the ethics then, right, yes, will return to the incest taboo, but I think that the incest taboo will be a question of very real, in an almost literal spatiality, or have to be reconsidered in terms of rather mechanical spatiality, in terms of the actual practical questions governing the construction of a biological being outside its normal environment. So I these are questions, they're not, you know, I'm troubled by it too. We don't even know yet whether a cloned sheep has the same psychic responses to life than a sheep. So I mean we're not quite there yet. I think that's true. I think one could work that even further, but I think that in articulating the imaginary and the symbolic, you have, and it's in a sense the interference that the imaginary runs against or across the symbolic that increasingly leads to questions of like flattening and distanciation at the same time. Alienated flattening, if you like. And I think that would be a moment where you could begin to structure an analysis of what new kinds of representation are doing. But that's my sort of hunch. What did Fred say? Yeah. Right. Right. Yeah. I think the implications of what I'm saying, certainly I try to work this out in the book, of that space itself
and our preoccupation about space in the late 20th and early 21st century is a nostalgia, because in a sense, that particular mode of representation that I was talking about under the sign of the digital has in fact dispensed with space. And I think even as Proust was in spatial terms trying to recover lost time from the 19th century, I think we're in a condition of trying to recover lost space. So lost in space becomes more than a title for one of Mark Wigley's best lectures. Thank you.
Thank you.